Welcome to Four Corners. Tonight we bring you the story that's making news around the world, the Paradise Papers. It's the largest leak of documents in history, revealing the hidden financial dealings of the world's rich and powerful, including top corporations, 120 politicians, oligarchs, celebrities, and even the Queen. Following the revelations we brought you in last year's Panama Papers, Four Corners has now been given access to more than 13 million documents in partnership with the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. The documents were originally leaked to the German newspaper Süddeutsche Zeitung. Among the scores of high-profile names in the documents is Donald Trump's Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross, with new details on his financial ties to a Russian company controlled by members of Vladimir Putin's inner circle. The offshore financial dealings of the world's top corporations are also exposed, including companies doing big business in Australia, like Nike and the giant Swiss commodities firm Glencore. Even the financial affairs of the late rock star Michael Hutchins are captured in the Paradise Papers. The most significant documents in this leak, almost 7 million, come from an offshore law firm called Appleby, operating in the tax haven of Bermuda. Marion Wilkinson began her investigation there.
In the Atlantic Ocean off America's east coast is a string of islands once famous for its buccaneers. The tiny British territory of Bermuda looks like heaven. But it's better known as a haven for big corporations and the super rich to avoid paying taxes in their home country.
The most recent data tell us that US companies reported a little over $100 billion of profits that they claim they're earning in Bermuda. The main problem with this is that the entire Bermuda economy is about $6 billion. So US companies are reporting a flow of profits in Bermuda that is roughly 18 times the size of the country's entire economy. Pretty clearly, the vast majority of these profits are purely an accounting fiction.
We're going to Bermuda because it's one of the most notorious tax havens in the world. This dot on the map is where our investigation begins. Bermuda is a holiday playground for famous A-listers like New York billionaire Michael Bloomberg and Hollywood actor Michael Douglas. Last year, Oxfam named Bermuda the worst tax haven on the planet.
Oxfam need to concentrate their efforts on actually feeding those hungry babies instead of paying attention to people like places like Bermuda.
Former Finance Minister Bob Richards insists Bermuda is a legitimate financial centre that shares tax information with other countries.
So, Mr. Richards, would you deny that Bermuda's a tax haven?
Absolutely.
But what's Bermuda's corporate tax rate?
A tax haven and a tax rate are not the same thing. They're not even related. A tax haven, in modern vernacular, means a place where people can hide dirty money, where corporations can do illegal and nefarious things, places that are magnets for money laundering and things of that nature, anti-terrorist financing. All that is what goes with a tax haven. We do not do those things. Our tax rate is a matter for the people of Bermuda.
It's zero, isn't it?
It has always been zero. Always.
That zero tax rate brings big business to Bermuda. If you want to avoid taxes on your corporate profits or private wealth, chances are you'll hire a lawyer in Bermuda. If you want one of the best, you'll come to this discreet office. The name on the door is Appleby.
Their clients are top-shelf clients. I mean, you're talking about the biggest corporations in the world. And they go to Appleby to help basically hide their money and to move their money around the world so that they pay less taxes.
The firm was founded in Bermuda in 1898 by Major Reginald Appleby, a cricket-loving, tea-drinking Anglophile. Today, Appleby is one of the top offshore law firms in the world. Using a tax haven can be a legitimate business practice. And Appleby argues everything it does is perfectly legal. But that's hard to know because much of their work has been hidden from public view until now. For years, Appleby has held in its offshore files the secrets of celebrities, rich listers, and top corporations. Now, those secrets are blown.
What we're looking at here is the biggest leak in history, looking at 13.5 million documents. And it comes from 21 different sources. You're looking at two law firms that specialize in offshore tax havens, but you're also looking at 19 company registers. In other words, these are the registries that countries keep of their offshore holdings, of people that come and register in their countries.
The leak is called the Paradise Papers. The documents cover tax havens all over the world. Almost 7 million documents come from Appleby. The Paradise Papers unravels the offshore financial affairs of some of the world's top corporations, as well as the rich and famous.
There are very powerful people and their secrets in these documents.
They include the Queen, whose personal estate is tied up with an offshore fund that invested in a finance company accused of predatory lending. Canadian billionaire Stephen Bronfman, a close confidant and fundraiser for Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Bronfman is embroiled in a controversy over millions of dollars moved into offshore trusts. Russian tech guru Yuri Milner. His firm was used to funnel huge investments into Mark Zuckerberg's Facebook that were bankrolled by a Kremlin-controlled company. Milner also personally invested in a startup company co-founded by Trump's son-in-law, Jared Kushner. Australian billionaire James Packer and his former partner, Lawrence Ho, used Appleby to set up their Macau casino, Studio City, offshore in the British Virgin Islands. And the late Michael Hutchins had his intellectual property hawked by an offshore company set up to exploit the 20th anniversary of the rock star's death.
These are documents that, you know, people never thought would ever see the light of day.
In Washington, D.C., the giant database of financial documents was dropped to the ICIJ, the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. The documents were obtained by the German newspaper Süddeutsche Zeitung following last year's publication of the Panama Papers. As a member of ICIJ, Four Corners was given access to the new secret database.
But we are seeing things that people need to know about. We're seeing the lengths that companies do go to avoid taxes. We're seeing secrets. There are more than 120 politicians around the world that we found in the documents. And I think the public has a right to know what we're going to reveal.
The most prominent politician in the Paradise Papers is a senior member of the Trump administration. When Trump was elected, he handpicked key members of his cabinet from the super rich. The leaked documents now reveal that one of those cabinet secretaries had extensive dealings in tax havens. He's the US Secretary of Commerce, and his job is to be the voice of business in the Trump administration. Billionaire Wilbur Ross is a longtime friend of Donald Trump.
Well, I believe that we need some mechanism that helps finance exports.
At his nomination hearings, Wilbur Ross came under attack from Democrats over his Wall Street career and his business dealings with Russia.
Mr. President, I rise today to oppose President Trump's nomination of Wilbur Ross for Secretary of Commerce. Mr. Ross is a Wall Street billionaire with a long history of profiting from the suffering of others. He also has shady ties to Vladimir Putin's Russia. That's just his record.
Documents leaked from Appleby give new insights on how Wilbur Ross still profits from a company run by President Putin's inner circle, including his son-in-law, Kirill Shamilov. Ross's former private equity firm, W.L. Ross & Co., had scores of companies created or maintained by Appleby, most of them in the Cayman Islands tax haven. Several held stakes in a big U.S. shipping company called Navigator Holdings.
Wilbur Ross's private equity fund started investing in Navigator Holdings in 2011, and by 2012, he was a majority shareholder in Navigator. He also took a seat on the board of Navigator Holdings.
Navigator Holdings ships liquid petroleum gas. One of its biggest clients is the Russian energy giant, Seabor.
Seabor's owners are members of Vladimir Putin's inner circle. They include his son-in-law, Kirill Shamilov, who's married to Putin's youngest daughter, Gennady Timchenko, who's a Russian oligarch who's been sanctioned by the United States and European Union since 2014.
Gennady Timchenko, for many years, has been known as one of the inner circle of Putin's cronies. Now, I should explain the term. Russia has a class of rich businessmen called oligarchs. They all must, in some way these days, collaborate with the system. But cronies are a particular subset of this group. They are people who are personally, financially involved with Putin. They are people who have helped make him wealthy, often, we suspect, through corrupt means. This is not a secret. These people have been known for a long time. If
anything, former U.S. Ambassador Daniel Freed coordinated President Obama's sanctions policy against Russia after it invaded Ukraine.
We wanted to make it clear that Russian businessmen close to Putin, the people, the so-called cronies, who had helped make Putin an extraordinarily wealthy man, would suffer consequences for Putin's aggression.
Seabor itself was not sanctioned, so it could trade with the West. But other companies associated with its largest shareholders, Gennady Timchenko and Leonid Mikhelson, were hit with trade restrictions.
Leonid Mikhelson, who's reputed to be the richest man in Russia, and his company, Novatek, has also been sanctioned by the United States.
Wilbur Ross stepped down from the board of Navigator Holdings after the sanctions were imposed. But it now appears when Ross joined the Trump administration, he kept a stake in Navigator worth millions of dollars.
Wilbur Ross seems to have kept his stake in Navigator Holdings, even though he continues to serve as Commerce Secretary. And he's kept that stake through a chain of Cayman Islands companies that are managed by Appleby, the offshore law firm whose documents are at the heart of this project.
Take me down to...
In his ethics disclosure form, Wilbur Ross did say he was keeping a stake in several Cayman Islands companies. But the Appleby leak makes it clear for the first time the companies are linked to Navigator Holdings and its Russian contracts. In a statement, Wilbur Ross said he had undertaken to recuse himself in any matter where he had a conflict of interest with his role as US Secretary of Commerce. He also said he had never met the three Putin cronies in Seabor.
I will say, as a general rule, my advice in and out of government would be the same. keep yourself several degrees of separation from sanctioned individuals.
The Paradise Papers will add to the political pressure on the Trump administration. But they will also refocus public scrutiny on US multinational tax avoidance. In Australia, multinational companies have long been accused of not paying their fair share of tax. Sportswear company Nike goes to great lengths to market and sell its expensive shoes here, like putting on a run club at Sydney's Bondi Beach.
Today's all about just testing out the brand and seeing if you like it. For Nike, we have our faster shoes, which are for sprinting. We have our softer shoes, which are for longer running, and we have our training shoes. So that's generally for cross training in the gym style running. So Nike's the best shoe, yeah.
Despite selling around $500 million worth of sports gear in Australia last year, Nike only paid around $4.5 million in tax. That's because Nike recorded tiny profits here, around 2% of its sales. But analysts argue Nike has been shifting its profits into tax havens.
We know that they're shifting their profits out of the US and other countries and into tax havens at a pretty fast clip. Last year alone, Nike increased their permanently reinvested offshore cash by $1.5 billion. What that means is they have $1.5 billion of profits that they say they're earning somewhere other than developed nations and on which they're paying virtually no tax.
The Paradise Papers help explain how Nike does it. For years, the rights to Nike's iconic swoosh logo and its trademark shoes were held in companies in Bermuda maintained by Appleby.
A few years ago, we noticed that Nike had something like a dozen subsidiaries in Bermuda. Itself kind of a strange thing to do, but that they were naming all of them after specific shoe brands. The most likely scenario is that Nike is doing what a bunch of other companies have done, shifting their intangible profits into Bermuda.
There are no Nike stores in Bermuda, but Nike recorded billion-dollar profits here with the help of Appleby. Nike's Bermuda companies charged expenses like big royalty fees on shoes sold around the world. They booked the profits here where they could avoid tax.
It's justifiable to write off these expenses, and certainly Nike can reduce its pre-tax income in the US or in Australia by the amount of these expenses. But it sure looks like Nike, like many other companies, is artificially inflating these expenses in an effort to shift its profits from Australia, from the US, to tax havens.
Nike shut down its Bermuda operation 3 years ago. It now uses companies in the Netherlands, another low-tax nation, to shift its profits.
Companies are able to use the Netherlands as sort of a conduit in channeling its royalty income from developed nations into tax havens. So having a subsidiary in the Netherlands is, I would say, every bit as indicative of tax avoidance activity as having a subsidiary in Bermuda or the Cayman Islands.
Nike declined to be interviewed by Four Corners, but said in a statement it complies with tax regulations and ensures its tax filings are aligned with its business.
In a number of cases, they flew their global tax...
The Australian Tax Office has ramped up its efforts against multinational tax avoidance, targeting companies like Apple and Google with the help of new laws. But it's an uphill battle.
There are 1,300 large businesses operating in Australia, and it's hard for me to sit here and say we've got them all covered at this stage. I think, though, we've got the market leaders in every sector covered, And I think that we've recouped a lot of tax that may have been lost in previous years. We issued $4 billion worth of back assessments last year.
Four Corners can reveal the ATO is already pressing its global contacts for access to the leaked Paradise Papers for investigations in Australia.
We have been able to use networks that we have established around the world to get access to that data. We're hoping quite soon to get access to that data ourselves and begin analysing the Australian implications of that data set.
The tax office is currently pursuing inquiries into tax avoidance by multinational mining and energy companies.
It's approaching 20, maybe, about that figure. Our audits in energy and resources is really around the amount of debt and the pricing of debt that's being placed into Australian subsidiaries by foreign companies, and also the use of hubs in low-tax jurisdictions.
But I think we could have broken the story up into three.
One giant resources company under audit by the tax office is heavily featured in the Paradise Papers.
One day, two day, three.
It was Applebee's third biggest client until recently, and hundreds of its confidential emails, board minutes and papers are exposed. It's the Swiss mining and commodities company, Glencore.
It operates in six continents around the world. The only continent it's not on that I'm aware of is Antarctica. It deals with more than 90 different commodities. It employs over 150,000 people plus contractors. It's a truly global enterprise that deals with a lot of the things that we need in order to fuel our lives, in order to fuel our bodies.
We're all over the world. We're in the CIS, we're in Australia, we're in South America, we're in Africa.
Its chief executive, Ivan Glazenberg, and his partners made a fortune when Glencore listed on the London Stock Exchange.
So I think we're well set for the future. Thank you.
There are four partners that are listed on the Forbes billionaires list. Glazenberg's net worth right now is estimated at about $6.2 billion.
When Glencore merged with Xstrata, a company it part-owned, it took over many Australian mines.
They wanted to create a huge multinational conglomerate that had a much more robust mining piece than what they had prior to the deal. Now, they did mining as well, but this gave them a level of scale where they are now top competitors with BHP Billiton, Rio Tinto, Vale, and others.
Glencore is Australia's biggest coal miner and also exports copper, zinc, nickel, oil, grain and cotton.
Come around, Brad, we got a change.
But the company has been dogged by allegations of aggressive tax avoidance and bitter disputes with unions, like this one in central Queensland. Glencore has locked out striking workers at its Oakey Creek mine for more than 3 months in a toxic battle with the CFMEU as the company tries to cut overtime and entitlements in exchange for small pay rises.
Solidarity. Australian jobs. They're getting taken one by one.
The union wants to keep their old agreements and argues Glencore can well afford to pay.
Coal's at $210 a tonne. This is a metallurgical coal mine. It should be a place where you print money, you know? But at the end of the day, if they're not making money, it's because obviously the direction of the way they're managing the place.
Glencore does earn a lot of money in Australia. In 2014, it reaped over $23 billion in revenue, but its losses and expenses were so great, it paid less than 1% of that in corporate tax.
Well, it's a typical pattern that you would say many companies that are involved in the extractive industries have used to basically move income from high-tax jurisdictions to low-tax jurisdictions. It's just a tax avoidance scheme. It's been done by dozens of companies. The mineral industry is rife with this behavior. I think Glencore is one of the more egregious participants in this, but it's not unusual.
Glencore's Australian office says its profits and taxes here were affected by lower commodity prices and some inherited dud deals. But they were also affected by the big debts over its Australian operations. This leaked document shows Glencore's heavy reliance on debt from its merger with Xstrata. The debt restructure used a Glencore finance company in Bermuda. Glencore's Australian subsidiaries had a whopping $11.6 billion in debt by 2014, with few profits and little tax paid, despite its huge revenue.
There's almost a force of gravity in the system that rewards companies and their management and their advisors for the avoidance of tax.
Former Deputy Tax Commissioner Jim Killaley can't talk directly about Glencore, but he explains how big debts can give big tax deductions to foreign companies in Australia.
Well, there's a huge tax advantage. Interest is tax deductible, and it's paid out of your earnings before you pay any tax. So it's much more tax efficient to fund your subsidiaries with debt.
The Paradise Papers show Glencore organised the financing of its debt with the help of Appleby. Glencore didn't have an office in Bermuda, but Appleby gave it a phone line, a computer, and lawyers on tap. In this building behind me, two local Appleby lawyers signed financial documents for Glencore involving millions and sometimes billions of dollars. On the face of it, it seems absurd that one of the world's largest commodities companies would put such enormous power in the hands of two lawyers from Bermuda.
It would seem curious to me that you've got unrelated directors sitting in a low-tax jurisdiction controlling significant values of flows. It just seems a bit commercially unreal to me.
The leaked documents show Glencore used Appleby to help hedge its debt deals with exotic financial contracts called cross-currency interest rate swaps. These swaps can be perfectly valid, but they can also be used by multinationals to avoid tax.
If they're different subsidiaries within the same group, the swap can actually be financially engineered so that the loss appears in whatever country you want it to, and the corresponding profit appears in whatever country you want that to land in. And it's like they've taken money out of one pocket and put it into the other pocket. They've still got the money, but they haven't paid tax.
Glencore told Four Corners it had used the scheme legitimately, but dropped it last year in its Australian operations. Glencore insists this was not because of action by the ATO. The tax office is now inquiring into the scheme's abuse.
It took us a little while to detect it, but now we have. We are following that up. We're making a lot of inquiries about it.
Have you got a number of companies in your sights on those schemes?
Yeah, we've got 19 active inquiries at the moment.
2 years ago, Glencore was hammered by the markets when commodity prices dropped. Investor pressure finally forced CEO Ivan Glasenberg to cut Glencore's staggering debt loads.
They sold off a number of assets. They lowered their net debt. Today, I believe it's about half of where it was at the end of 2015. It's gone to roughly $15 billion from roughly 30.
Glencore says it's now slashing its Australian debt by $4 billion US dollars. It told Four Corners it is not under tax audit over its debt levels, but is discussing them with the ATO this month. Glencore also expects to pay more tax this year on higher profits.
In a tax world, the line between law and, you know, illegality is always fuzzy. And it's a kind of probability distribution of, you know, will we get audited? You know, how long will that take? You know, what are the chances we will survive?
Appleby insists what they do in the offshore world is legitimate. But the Paradise Papers reveal they were prepared to bend the rules in some very dubious deals, including one to exploit the legacy of Australian rock star Michael Hutchins. The In Excess frontman was a superstar.
Michael was kind of a unique, and that's why people are still interested. He had a presence on stage that was kind of unsurpassed. He was incredibly sexual and beautiful to watch. Great performer and a sort of a really gentle kind of soul, and it's unfortunate that it gets trashed.
Welcome to Four Corners. Tonight we bring you the story that's making news around the world, the Paradise Papers. It's the largest leak of documents in history, revealing the hidden financial dealings of the world's rich and powerful, including top corporations, 120 politicians, oligarchs, celebrities, and even the Queen. Following the revelations we brought you in last year's Panama Papers, Four Corners has now been given access to more than 13 million documents in partnership with the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. The documents were originally leaked to the German newspaper Süddeutsche Zeitung. Among the scores of high-profile names in the documents is Donald Trump's Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross, with new details on his financial ties to a Russian company controlled by members of Vladimir Putin's inner circle. The offshore financial dealings of the world's top corporations are also exposed, including companies doing big business in Australia, like Nike and the giant Swiss commodities firm Glencore. Even the financial affairs of the late rock star Michael Hutchins are captured in the Paradise Papers. The most significant documents in this leak, almost 7 million, come from an offshore law firm called Appleby, operating in the tax haven of Bermuda. Marion Wilkinson began her investigation there.
In the Atlantic Ocean off America's east coast is a string of islands once famous for its buccaneers. The tiny British territory of Bermuda looks like heaven. But it's better known as a haven for big corporations and the super rich to avoid paying taxes in their home country.
The most recent data tell us that US companies reported a little over $100 billion of profits that they claim they're earning in Bermuda. The main problem with this is that the entire Bermuda economy is about $6 billion. So US companies are reporting a flow of profits in Bermuda that is roughly 18 times the size of the country's entire economy. pretty clearly the vast majority of these profits are purely an accounting fiction.
We're going to Bermuda because it's one of the most notorious tax havens in the world.
All I've got now is the police inventory showing all of Michael's items on it.
Rhett is still angry that the family got nothing from Hutchins' estate despite a long, costly legal battle.
All the money slowly dwindled to a point where we became pecuniary beneficiaries, meaning that there was nothing left for any of us, for anybody really. For nothing. Yeah, there was nothing there. It all got chewed up in legal fees. They sold off a lot of his assets even, you know, to do that.
Now, documents leaked from Appleby reveal Colin Diamond is not just claiming to be Hutchins' trustee, but the ultimate beneficial owner of all the Star's remaining assets held in Chardonnay Investments. In a leaked email from 2015, Colin Diamond's lawyer tells Appleby,
Chardonnay is controlled by Colin Diamond, and by virtue of him being the ultimate beneficial owner, he controls the assets of Chardonnay. The reason for this is that he was a trusted friend of Michael Hutchins and that he had various family issues.
Rhett Hutchins disputes Diamond's claim to be the ultimate beneficial owner of his brother's rights.
I'm not even sure whether he has the right to have these rights. He's never shown anybody in court. Nobody's challenged him enough to take him to court to show him, for him to show that he has these rights. I don't believe he does. I really don't.
Appleby's lawyers knew Michael Hutchins' estate was disputed, but in December 2015, they agreed to set up a company to allow Diamond to cash in on the 20th anniversary of the rock star's death. The joint venture was called Helipad Plane Limited, and its purpose included the
commercial exploitation of the sound recordings, images, films, and related materials embodying the performance of Michael Hutchins.
Diamond's interest was held by Chardonnay Investments. His partner was Ron Creevy, a discharged bankrupt turned tech entrepreneur. One of Creevy's investors was John Ibrahim, the notorious King of the Cross, an associate of organised crime. Creevy and Diamond planned to use a new documentary on Hutchins to promote a trove of his unreleased songs and profit from the music rights held by Chardonnay.
How did you get your hands on these 15 songs?
I heard about it some time back, and I've been speaking with the group that has worked with Michael, including Michael's or Tiger's godfather.
The Channel 7 documentary, The Last Rockstar, was the vehicle for Diamond and Creevy's plan. But Creevy fell out with Diamond and says he walked away with nothing.
Colin was one of the executors of Michael's estate.
Colin Diamond became a star of the show in the role of Tiger Lily's godfather.
Later that year, while on a trip away, Michael wrote this in his diary.
CD. Cole Diamond, just want to get home to Paula and carry the baby.
Many of Hutchins' friends and family were stunned to see Diamond revealing the star's intimate possessions left in his room the night he died, even his diary.
Now, this is the same diary that they use in the doco. I don't know why they've got the... Why do they have the rights to have these things, to have first access to these things, to show the world these things, when they're not even, you know, they should be part of the, that should be part of the estate.
Diamond had claimed the deeply personal items as an executor of Hutchins' will 20 years ago. Now suddenly he was exploiting them, including the last words the singer wrote.
Michael Hutchins didn't leave a suicide note, but in his room, in his distinctive handwriting, police found the lyrics to his last song.
I mean, the night he died, he'd written music, which, you know, we've got the lyrics.
That was left in his hotel room?
That was left in his hotel room. He was riding right up until that evening.
It's the family stuff. It should have been all delivered over upon Michael's death, but no, he kept it, and he's still got it. None of that stuff has ever been released to the family. It was just another little poke in the guts, basically.
Since Michael Hutchins' death, his rights are estimated to have earned a fortune. It now appears that money went to Colin Diamond to use at his discretion.
Over the past 20 years, it would have to be tens of millions of dollars, without a doubt. Maybe 30, maybe 50, I would think.
Channel 7 said it didn't pay Diamond for his cooperation in the documentary, but it did heavily promote the Hutchins songs he will profit from. Colin Diamond did not respond to our approaches. We understand he has made payments over the years to Tiger Lily, but not the full value of her father's rights. The rest of the family got nothing.
I think it's about time we had a platform and told what's been going on, because it's injustice, you know. What has happened is injustice.
Despite recent efforts to make the offshore world more transparent, it is still difficult for the public to know what goes on here. Before we left Bermuda, we approached Appleby with a request for an interview, joined by a number of our colleagues from ICIJ. No one was prepared to talk to us.
We're not allowed to be invited in. We're okay to come in.
So unfortunately, there's no one here to talk to you right now.
Sure.
Thank you for your business cards.
Sure.
What I will do is have them reach out via email, someone who can speak with you. There's no one here at this time.
Appleby said in a statement it had investigated all the allegations we put to it.
We are satisfied that there is no evidence of any wrongdoing, either on the part of ourselves or our clients.
Appleby also said its data had been breached. Australian tax authorities say that should be a warning.
These firms say we offer comprehensive security and privacy, but the guy fixing the server strips all the data, or an employee who becomes disillusioned with what they're seeing takes all the data. Our general warning is don't get involved in these sorts of scheme arrangements. Don't get involved with these sort of secrecy arrangements, because our experience is that they do go wrong, and when they go wrong, it is very bad for you.
There is a valid argument that offshore firms can operate legally and legitimately. But some bend or break the law, and so do their clients. And tax authorities around the world are now finally putting them under scrutiny.
There is a need for us globally as revenue administrations to work together to look at what these intermediaries are up to and attempt to disrupt their operations.
As long as wealthy corporations and the super rich can use the offshore world to aggressively avoid tax and shield their dealings, the burden of paying for a civil society will increasingly fall on the rest of us.
You can find responses from some of the companies and individuals identified in the Paradise Papers on our website. And keep up with new revelations in the story at ABC News Online. Next week, the federal government in turmoil. Can Malcolm Turnbull hold his party together? See you then.